I'm Greg Scallon. The company we represent is called Commercial Computer Systems. We're going to talk a little bit today about optimizing flow graphs. We had a contract from DARPA. Tom Rondeau, then we were looking for an opportunity to show what we could do. Tom suggested a problem that he got from GNU Radio. He gave us this, the flow graph, ATSC flow graph, and says, what can you do with that? And what we had advertised is that we have tools that help you do more with less, optimize systems and performance. So this to us, this was relatively simple, except that all of the interfaces are data-driven as opposed to event-driven, and most of our other software consultation had done with event-driven systems, military typically. Marcus actually provided us some information. He went back and instrumented the configuration, the flow graph you've seen there, and provided the information shown on the left side of the screen, the one to the left of the yellow line. And from this, we derived some measurements for the individual components. These we put into our modeling system to go back and say, if you really built this system, how would it behave? How many processors do you have? At any point in time, what processor does what next? How does the data flow, et cetera? From that model, we can go back and measure various things. The measurements that we achieved from the model are shown here. Then we went back and correlated the measurements we saw with the raw data that Marcus had got it, and overall within 0.5%, worst case error was, I think, 3.2%. On this graph, it shows the 14 steps or stages or blocks associated with the flow graph. The two bars, the left bar shows the percent of a CPU or GPU that block consumes. The right-hand bar shows how long the particular task lasts, and we normalize them. The Viterbi, for instance, over there shown in purple, you'll see that the right-hand bar is 100%. So he ran longer than anybody else. But we look over here at the second one, the RX filter. Now, he consumed more resources. Obviously, he runs 6 times faster than Viterbi does, even though each particular run is slightly less than half the size. So he's the big consumer. Once we had this data together and correlated it and went back and had confidence that our model seemed to agree with the raw data, we went back and plotted it. In our model, we went back and changed. What happens if you ran all of this stuff on one processor versus 6, which is what Marcus ran it on? And you see the number of processors across the bottom to the right. And the thing that we noticed right away is that adding processors, once you hit a little knee in the curve, doesn't do any help. Likewise, we were interested at the very bottom, we showed the jitter, the output jitter. How regularly are the productions made from this flow graph? Some of the other characteristics that we plotted on here were the latency. How long does it take from a sample entering the system until it comes out of the system? The red dotted line in there shows the sample problem that we applied it to. And it was a movie, a 10-minute movie. Animation, and so we ran it over and over again so we could go back and conduct these experiments to get these trades. Armed with this information, then we went back and we thought that we want to improve something. So the first thing we thought we could do is, we guessed, would be to improve the output jitter, make it more regular so it would be smoother playback. And so we tried immediately some priorities. So we decided to take the individual blocks and prioritize them based upon their order of execution, and then the reverse order, based upon individual execution duration, or largest and smallest, the total resource consumption, the largest and smallest. And then we tried a handful of just sort of random, assigning priorities randomly to see if there was maybe something that we missed. Quickly, we came to the conclusion, after running those various models, we came to the conclusion that priority isn't going to change anything. The output jitter, as we went back and looked at the data, traced it back, the output jitter is caused because some of the individual blocks sometimes to produce an output, sometimes they have to wait for 3, this kind of stuff. So there's inherent, if you would, clumping of information as it moves through the system. Then we recognized immediately that the RX filter was the tent pole. Once the RX filter is running to capacity, in other words, if it runs continuously, then everybody downstream is going to be starved, since the RX filter takes more resources than anybody else. Everybody downstream takes less resource. In other words, they're going to finish faster than the RX filter. So that would explain the previous chart, why it leveled off. All the little green lines at the bottom are all leveled. Once you turn the corner at about four machines, it didn't matter. You could add any number of processors, and you're not going to get any improvement in throughput. The average load on each processor will go down, but there'll be no system level improvement in what you're going to get. So then it was the idea that in order to make this thing more effective or process more data or be more efficient, you want to reduce how long it takes the RX filter block to run. And we tried some stuff. We looked at overlapping and parallelizing the filters. What we mean by the parallelizing is maybe have two streams, have the filter for the even samples and a filter for the odd samples, so you could overlap them and hence cut the load in half. And we looked at that would require significant code changes that we weren't prepared to look at. The other one in here about overlapping, maybe we could start some later than the other, and we looked at what that would mean relative to reentrancy, and that was out also. So then it was, let's exploit the Intel architecture to better utilizes those resources. In other words, make that particular block of code run faster, even if the other blocks ran slower, because that would allow us to improve the overall system response. First thing we noticed is that Marcus's data was all collected on a hyperchannel and a hyper-threaded machine. So we looked at the hyper-threaded machine, and on the left side down here shows a typical non-hyper-threaded arrangement. And the upper chart shows that the general processing unit has a certain throughput, and you get 100% of it. You have one processor, you use it all. The hyper-thread side on the right-hand column, Intel advertises that you get from 15 to 30% system improvement using hyper-threading. So we said, if that's the case, then we said that the two individual general processing units, which share the floating point unit, they also share the memory access controller, each of those will be hampered by contention with his sibling, with his neighbor, and using the Intel data of 30%, then that would say that each of those two are running not at 100%, but at 65%. So we said, aha, if we just ran the RX filter in a non-hyper-threaded mode, this would we should get a up to 50% increase in throughput. So with this data, then we suggested to Marcus that he run some tests for us. And Marcus ran these tests and some other tests that we're not going to talk about at this session and produced this kind of data. And you'll see down here the three bars. The first bar shows the blue bar for any given block. It shows the runtime relative in a hyper-threaded mode. The red one shows the non-hyper-threaded mode. And just a cursory look shows that we did not get a 50% increase in anything with the non-hyper-threaded. And in fact, in one of them, we'll look down here, I think it's FPP0, it actually reversed. It turns out that running it in the hyper-thread was actually faster than running it normal, and that seemed to be counterintuitive. So obviously our idea that it was the floating point unit, the fact that they had to share those resources between two general purpose processors, our assumption is invalid. So then we looked at it and we said, well, it must be the other thing. It must be this memory access controller. So we look at the Intel memory hierarchy for the particular chip. The i7 family of chip is diagrammed in this little sketch. And it shows that for any given core in a hyper-channel mode, hyper-threaded mode, you have two general purpose processing units that share a floating point engine, and they share an L2 cache. The size of that cache is 256 kilobytes, and it takes about 10 clocks to access it. And these clocks are typically 3 gigahertz or slightly higher. Then if you go to the L3 cache, and the L3 cache allows individual cores to talk to their neighbors, it's slower depending upon where your neighbor is and a bunch of other things. And they take between 40 and 75 cycles. If I divide that by three, I have in the neighborhood of 20 or so nanoseconds to make that. And then, of course, you have RAM. And RAM is slow relative to these other numbers. It's in a neighborhood of 100 nanoseconds to make an access there. So we said, aha, given this, there is a natural communication affinity between siblings. So then we went back and we tried the top part of the chart's duplicate from before, and we said, aha, if we could put the RX filter and the block that provides it, provides the inputs to it, and the block that consumes the products, and put them all in one core, two different, the red and the green GPUs, actually, that should run faster. And so then we made some experiments and we tried that. And the answer was it did. In order to run, this diagram tries to show how all of that would fit together in time reading left to right. The file source produces data, reads data, in our case, off of a tape or off of the disk, and submits it into the RX filter. And the RX filter runs and produces data, which we just call blue. It submits that to the receiver, phase lock loop, to begin the sequence of blocks associated with this flow. And obviously, to make the RX filter run continuously, if it didn't run continuously, then it's even slower than normal. But if it runs continuously, then those blocks have to be double buffered. So this we modeled, and we came up and we checked it against real hardware. So we put in a Intel i7 machine, normalized the speed, got everything working. And it turns out we got an 18.1% system throughput improvement. In other words, and that's all traceable back to the RX filter. The RX filter ran 18.1% faster, or consumed 18.1% less resource than it did before. And we haven't changed any code, haven't changed any data, and it's real data. I mean, it really performed the function. Well, if it's good for the front end, then it must be good for the back end also. The back end being the Viterbi, the second one. So we did the same kind of thing with Viterbi. The input block on there shown, or the Viterbi shown in violet, the orange block that fed it, and the blue block that consumed the product, we put those in the same core, in two siblings in the same core. Then we were left with, if you would, the other pieces in there that weren't of great concern, and we stacked those in a third processor. So we had a system that ran in three cores. The system that ran in three cores actually was 18.1% better than the equivalent system running in six cores, allowing the scheduler or the operating system to dynamically assign individual blocks to particular threads. What all of this means is that to take advantage of this, we showed how you could take advantage of it in terms of if you're doing more with less, that means you can either use cheaper hardware, or you can run more samples through. So using our standard, if you would, our standard test case, the movie, it took 600 or 599 seconds worth of real-time processing. And you'll see that as soon as in the brown lines up here, as soon as you approach 2 gigahertz, you can't run in real time anymore. Where the blue lines allow you to go all the way down to about 1.65 or so gigahertz. So you can use cheaper hardware, or that translates into better battery life, all kinds of other benefits. But anyway, this was the improvement that we found by just changing the L2 cache, and if you would, locking in various blocks to particular caches in a strategy designed to exploit the L2 communication mechanism. There's more to this, the other half of this dealing with the what we do about buffer sizes and how sensitive performance is to buffer sizes. And then the other one, people are asking us about what happens if you have different architecture. So the other architecture my compatriot's going to talk about tomorrow or Thursday is the AMD machine. What happens if you run it on that? Do you have any questions? Well, thank you for your attention.
Is someone else? Oh, there you are. Okay, good. I just wanted to make sure you're actually here. Were there no questions? I'm sure there's some, because we have plenty of time.
Oh.
What was unusual about that receiving filter that used up all those resources?
Oh, it turns out the rate. The receive filter runs very much more often than anybody else in the system. It's the first block that the raw data sees.
Okay.
It actually runs much shorter than, say, Viterbi, but it runs 6 times more often. So the net effect is it does less work, but it does it 6 times as often. So it consumes, on the average, on the aggregate, more work.
Was this a shaping filter for the square root Nyquist filter with 11% excess bandwidth? Well, you don't know.
I must apologize. I do not know. To us, the entire GNU digital radio is a new field. We were typically interested, before we had specialized in event-driven simulations and large military systems. This is a data-driven system, and I can't answer that. I can give you the name of the module, but I do not know, I can't give you the characteristic.
I think I know where the problem is. That filter has very narrow transition bandwidth. It's the narrowest excess bandwidth of any shaping filter. It's 11%. So it's a killer filter. But there are ways of reducing the workload and still achieve it. And if you're interested, I can tell you how to do that.
Oh, that would be ideal. And that would be a simple trade to do, in which case somebody else would be the big work guy, in which case we would still suggest trying the same mapping of if you would, processors or GPUs that are in the same sibling relationship for the key path.
So you and I can talk later then. All right,
thank you. Thank you.
We have at least 2 questions on this side. So Nathan?
Can this automatically be like applied to other flow graphs? We
think so, because we think that the principles involved transcend any particular sample like this one. And so if you were to go back and find where you're spending most of the energy, and Marcus will talk about how to instrument and find out where that is, we would expect to see similar results. But since we've not done it, we can't, we're just, if you would, betting. But we'll bet you a quarter.
We have another question? Oh, okay. So then over here. Anyone else? So we can arrange microphones while.
So I had a question with regards to the operating system itself. You know, you talked about how, you know, normally when you schedule threads, the OS has kind of its own strategy for allocating if you don't specify. Has there been any talk about, you know, is there any lessons learned that you could actually then feed back, you know, into the Linux development community to say, is there any way to optimize your cache accesses and move and schedule threads to be running?
Right. Well, it turns out that, to my knowledge, that the best you can do about controlling cache is to control the if you would, the blocks that run through the cache. The data will follow the blocks. The data will find the path, whatever it takes, to get from here to there. If it's from here to there is quite short, then that path will be efficient. If it's quite long and involved, the path will be proportionately shorter. But you mentioned another one is the operating system. The operating system is the one who controls who does what. And it's the operating system that we changed with the affinity directive to lock in, if you would, to certain threads, the particular blocks of interest. Tomorrow, Kirby, we'll talk a little bit more about the effect of different versions of the operating system, what that has for performance. Yeah.
Anyone else?
Excuse me, not tomorrow, Thursday. Yeah.
Well, if there's no more questions, we'd like to thank Greg once again.
Thank you.
In particular, for actually putting us back on schedule. So we're not even in a rush, but the next presenter can start coming up to the front and setting up their gear. And while he does so, I'm just going to quickly repeat the announcements I did earlier, because I knew that I saw that people came in during this presentation. So there will be a Cyber Spectrum this Thursday at Qualcomm. Look up Cyber Spectrum.